All right, thank you very much. It is a pleasure to be here and to be able to speak about this. One of the reasons I wanted to speak about these things is because I think people are realizing that they are that non-commutative probability has started to become useful because, you know, it's sort of starting to match a lot of these random matrix bounds that you get in various situations. But if you go into the free probability literature, it's kind of a nightmare because the invention of free probability was not, it was invented for a purpose other than this. And so much of the language there is written in such a way that the people who the intended audience was for this particular stuff would understand it better. And for people like me, and I would assume you, this makes it very hard to get through. But in the end, essentially, we're going to do what a lot of very good combinatorists do, and that's take a problem that we, you know, don't really need to know all that much about, turn it into a power series, do something to that power series, and then out pops some other power series, and that new power series will be the thing that we're looking for. So in the end, you know, there's actually very little understanding that needs to happen. You can sort of turn it into some mechanical thing. Okay, so let me start by saying that usually you have some sort of object that you're interested in, and you sort of put some distribution on this object, and then you do something to this object, and then the outcome's a new distribution. You try to figure out this distribution. I'm not going to approach this in this way. I'm going to pretend that there are no objects. Really, for the moment, we're just going to pretend that there's no applications whatsoever for any of this. All I'm doing is I'm trying to come up with interesting distributions. Okay? And if later on we realize that, oh, these things happen to have distributions that match this interesting distribution, then we'll be happy. And I can sort of promise that that's going to be the case. But at the beginning, I think it helps to just understand, to just think in terms of distributions. So we just have distributions.
Over what?
Over the real line. So
real line, yeah.
Real line. Real distributions. And somehow I want to take a distribution and another distribution and then turn it into a third distribution. Now, distributions are kind of boring in that sense. I mean, they don't really interact with each other, which is why we have these things called random variables, right? So usually for a distribution, you have a random variable. And I should say that at this point, there's nothing different between non-commutative and commutative. I mean, distributions are just distributions. So what you do is you take your distribution and you form a random variable. And then if you want to form new distributions, what you do is you take various random variables and you do things to them, right? You do like x plus y or x squared y. And these give you new distributions. So this is sort of the level that I want to operate on for right now, these random variables. And in particular, I'm kind of want to forget that they even came from distributions. Okay? So really, I just sort of have, what are random variables? Well, they're formal variables. That you can do algebraic things to, right? So if x is in, you know, so if x is in your set, then you need to be able to do x plus y, and you should be able to do xy. So it should generate some sort of algebra that you can, you know, compute things on. And then last but not least, the thing that makes them interesting, more interesting than a formal variable, is that you have this expectation operator that you can hit any of these guys with and get out some number, right? This is sort of like your test function. And in particular, you need for this test function to be defined for all of the different combinations of you know, algebraic things that you can get.
Function on your algebra.
It's a function on your algebra. In particular, we're going to want it to be a linear function on the algebra. So at this point, what are we trying to deal with? We're just trying to deal with algebras with a linear function phi. For some reason, phi is what they always use in the literature.
The algebra is simply the algebra of polynomials.
So it depends on, so you can have smaller algebras, right? So you could have, right. So if you had, right, x, and the point is that phi needs to be defined for all, polynomials in the algebra.
There's some field in the background. It's a real numbers. So coefficients I can take, if I take x plus x, it's 2x.
Yes, you can do it. I don't think you need to do it that way, but I think it's... Right, so x plus x, yeah, so you would have to have, right, 2x. Yeah, you'd have to have some vector space or ring module or something. So something like this, if I had this vector space x and phi, in order for this to actually be a valid random variable space, I need to make sure that phi of x is defined, and phi of x squared is defined, phi of x cubed, and so on. Whether or not the identity is in your group kind of makes a difference. So these things are called unital if the identity is also in here. And for our purposes, we're just going to always sort of deal with unital things. I'll point out where things get a little bit different when, if you happen to have some situation where you don't want the identity to be in your thing.
And there's a natural way to think of the identity as a distribution?
No, we're not even thinking about distributions, no distributions. Just formal variables and some phi. And probably we want, you will just normalize it so that phi of the identity is 1. That makes things nicer. So a good thing, even right now, you can see that given what I've said, obviously these random variables sort of behave this way, but also matrices where phi is the trace, or I guess phi equals 1 over n. Times the trace of whatever.
If it's n by n
matrices, also acts this way. So in some ways, we're going to see that in this sort of weird non-commutative extension, matrices themselves, deterministic matrices, are going to act like random variables. We're going to be able to treat them like random variables. Okay. So if I wanted to do, an algebra defined by I, x, and y, and phi, then I would need to define phi on things like x, y, x, and phi on x squared, y squared x, and all of these polynomials. And the one comment I want to make is that I can always sort of treat this, this algebra as a free algebra, right? So that it's non-commutative. Non-commuting. If I really wanted this to be a commuting situation, like I could define phi in such a way that, you know, phi of x, y is equal to phi of y, x. And all of the commutative things happen. So I can sort of push all of the commutative issues into phi. And so I can sort of treat this algebra as though it's really a non-commutative algebra, and then phi will make it commutative at some point if we want it to be. Okay? Any questions so far?
Sorry, is there any disadvantage to treating your algebra as a free algebra of non-commutative polynomials?
No, there's no disadvantage. In fact, I think it's an advantage because then you can sort of, you always remember that these guys are non-commutative, you can treat them non-commutatively and then push all of the commutative stuff to feed.
Just the field is not clear, but we might as well have the reals.
You might as well have the reals, yeah.
Okay, so it's a real,
yeah.
Very good non-commutative free algebra with up over the reals.
With some, yeah, with some linear function.
Yeah.
Okay. So now the question is, let's say that I have a unital algebra, I, x, and some phi x. And I have another one, I, y, and some phi y. Let's say that, the question is, can I make some new algebra, I, x, y, with some phi xy that sort of makes sense. So in particular, if I only use x's in my thing, then this should, you know, go back to whatever phi of x was, phi x told me. If I only use y in my polynomial, then it should go back to what this phi y is. But in particular, I'm kind of lazy and don't want to have to define phi xy for every single possible polynomial of these things, right? So the question becomes, is there some sort of universal phi xy that you can form from phi x and phi y that always works? It will be a bunch of linear conditions, exactly. So let me write some of those linear conditions. So what do I mean by universal? Well, first of all, we wanted the two properties we needed to have is that it should be associative. Right? If I form phi xy z, this should be the same as doing phi xyz. Right, the order that I combine these things in shouldn't matter. And then second, it should be consistent, which, as Avi said, is just a collection of linear equations. So for example,
any solution to this linear system will be associative,
That I don't know. So every proof that I've seen of this uses associativity. So when I show you what we're going to do, So what does consistency mean? It means that, remember, I'm trying to find this new, define this new algebra over here. And in order to do that, I need to tell you what phi xy is on every single polynomial. And I want it to be, because I don't want to have to make things up, I need it to be in terms of the phi x and the phi y. So in particular, what am I going to make phi xy of x times y be? Well, it can only really be some alpha times phi x of x times phi y of y by homogeneity and all of these things. The question then is, what is alpha? So if I happen to have the identity in my, if this happens to be a unital algebra, then what I can do is I can plug in the identity here and get that phi x y. So let's have x equal y equals the identity. So this should say phi xy of the identity is alpha times phi x of the identity, phi y of the identity. And so this tells you that alpha should be 1. So that's just tells you.
How do you know that it looks like this to begin with?
Because, so if you wanted to, so first of all, you need it to be homogeneous.
Definition of consistency,
right? Yeah.
in particular.
So if there was a phi, so I have to use phi x of something and phi y of something else, right? If I had phi x of x squared, then this wouldn't work because you would, it wouldn't be homogeneous in x, right? So you have to, so really the only thing that you can do is you can, you know x and y, and all you can do is do phi x to this guy and phi y to this guy, and they have to be multiplied together. So let me do another one. Were there questions?
Yeah, I mean, if I switch x and y around, then it doesn't tell you that it has to be commutative, does it?
Correct, yeah. So, yeah, but phi is going to end up giving me a real number. So
it is commutative.
So after phi... After phi's, so this at this point, phi of x, y has to be phi of y, x, if it's going to be universal. Yes. So at this point, phi x, y of x, y has to be phi x, y of y, x. OK, let me do another one. So what is phi x, y of x1, y, x2? Yeah. Yeah, so it turns out, yeah.
For two it's okay, but if you did three, yeah, okay.
So let's do phi xy of x1, y, x2, where x1 and x2 both come from the x algebra, and y comes from the y algebra. Well, since I'm treating this as a non-commutative thing, the only things out of here that I can essentially query are phi x of x1, x2. I can query phi x of x1 by itself and phi x of x2 by itself. And then I can query phi y of y. So phi y of y. So this has to be some alpha plus some beta times this thing. So it turns out that at 3, you're also commutative up to trace relations. The interesting one comes when you get to phi of x1, y1, x2, y2. This you have to then write as alpha phi x of x1, x2, phi y of y1, y2, plus beta phi x of x1, phi x of x2, phi y of y1, y2, and then two others. And the consistency means that what ends up happening is I plug in I for each of these things. It gives me some relations on these guys. And anything I do has to satisfy these relations. Okay, like in order for me to be, for this thing to be consistent. All right, so long story short.
Phi of x, y
will be the same as phi of y, x. But phi of, so phi of x, y need not be the same as phi of x squared, y squared. Yeah, essentially, if you do this, you can prove that phi has to have a tracial. It has to be a tracial state, so it you can.
So this is this equivalent to taking traces on an algebra? Or?
You could. I mean, taking traces on algebra is one valid use of this.
Can you always embed it into some trace structure somewhere?
Probably in a C star algebra of some sort. Yeah, probably. So for finite structures, things get weird because you can't actually satisfy these conditions. So, yeah. So.
I meant finite dimensional. Yeah.
Right, finite dimensional. You can't actually satisfy all of these. You can't get well. So, let me say what this. Sorry. So the claim is that when you, and this is a result of Spiker, when you write down all of these considerations and all these conditions that you need in order for this thing to be universal, and you add in the associativity, the theorem is that there are exactly two solutions that work. One is called the tensor product, and the other is called the free product. Yes. So the tensor product, how does the tensor product behave? So the tensor product phi of xy of x1, x2, x1, y1, y2, so on, is phi of x1, x2. So it's, commutative between the two. Times phi of y1, yn. So that's one rule that will satisfy all of these things for some alpha and beta. The other rule is slightly bizarre. And what it says is that, so this is the tensor rule. The free rule says that anytime phi of xi equals phi of yi equals 0 for all I, then phi of x1, y1, x2, y2, xn, yn equals 0. So how does that work for reducing things?
It
for all polynomials, yeah. Yeah. So, and I'll show you why. So let's say we wanted to solve, we wanted to reduce phi of xy, xy. Well, we don't know anything about x or y. And what we need is to have something where the phi is 0. So what we do is we form this new thing called x0, which is x minus I times phi of x. And then I form y0, which is y minus I times phi of y. OK? Now, these guys, I know phi of them is 0. So this tells me that phi of x0, y0, x0, y0 is 0. Now I can plug back in all these guys into here. So phi of x minus phi of x, y minus phi of y, and times the identity. Then multiply this whole thing out, use the linearity of phi, and then what will end up happening is you'll always get some phi of xy, xy, right? Because you have an xy, an xy, an xy, and then everything else you can sort of push to the other side, and that will give you whatever your formula is.
It's an inductive construction.
It's like an inductive construction.
Yeah, but it's not explicit.
Yeah.
It's a very similar way of, in non-commutative algebra, where they, you have to multi-linearize every polynomial.
Yeah, it's probably similar, yeah. Okay. So in particular, if you do this thing out, what you get is that phi of xy, xy is phi of x squared phi of y squared plus phi of x squared phi of y squared minus phi of x squared phi of y squared. Whereas if you just did phi of x squared y squared, this would just be phi of x squared phi of y squared. Right? Because this is some element in x, this is some element in y, and I can just separate them. So this is where this, you know, non-commutativity comes in. Essentially, if you wanted to have a system where, you know, x and y were non-commutative, doing this tensor rule kind of kills you because it, you know, sort of forces having commutativity after the fact. Whereas having this rule sort of allows you to maintain some amount of non-commutativity even after doing phi. Then they would become the same, yeah. But they don't have to be that way. Okay, any questions so far? Okay. So now I have this way of sort of joining two algebras together. And when I do that, now I can do this sort of idea where I can create new distributions. Right? So let's say that I was given I x with phi, and I was given I y with, so usually you have the same phi here. I think it's useful, it was useful over here to sort of distinguish what became, what belonged to x and what belonged to y, but normally we just have a phi. Then you might ask, what is I z phi where z equals x plus y, for example. So what do I need to tell you in order to make this an actual probability space? Well, I need to be able to tell you all of the power, what phi is on all of these powers. Right? So I need to tell you phi of z squared, phi of z cubed, so on. But these guys are just, you know, I can just plug in the fact that z equals x plus y, right? So this is phi of x plus y. This is phi of x squared plus xy plus yx plus y squared, so on. And so this is just now phi of some polynomial in x and y. So I can get the answer to this from this product that I made with x and with these two algebras. So essentially what I want to do is I want to take x and phi, y and phi, turn them into x, y, and phi. And then once I know phi for all of these guys, it's easy for me to tell you what phi of z is, because every time I need, this gets to x plus y phi. Because every time I need to, anytime you ask me what, you know, z to the k is, I just multiply that thing out. I look in this algebra and see what phi gave all of those little parts to, and then that's what, and then add them together, and I get this phi. Okay. Okay. So this tells us that we can, so this is, okay, this is sort of the main thing, is that given two spaces of variables, you can form this new space of variables with phi in such a way that every time you want to query something about this new variable, you can turn that query and you can reduce it to a bunch of queries of the individual variables. And the thing worth noticing is that this, at this point, x plus y is not well defined, because I haven't chosen whether, I haven't chosen what this means yet, right? I could have used the tensor product here to get this xy, or I could have used the free product to get this xy, to get this phi. If I use the tensor product to get this phi, then this turns into exactly what, you know, random variables you expect them to do, independent random variables. If you do the free product here before you reduce it to this, then you get what's called the free convolution. So this is just some new, given, you know, x and y, we formed some new variable x plus y. Okay, so remember we were not paying attention to distributions. Let's go back to paying attention to distributions, because now distributions matter. Because what do I want to do? I want to take some mu, which is a distribution. So I want to get that, to that at the very, very end. Yeah. Okay. So now, so I want to do this sort of idea of taking random variables and forming new random variables, but I really want to do it using distributions, right? Which is not an obvious thing, right? So if mu is a distribution, then I can form x and phi by letting phi of x to the k be integral, say, t to the k d mu of t. And then I can form theta, or given theta, I can form y phi by letting phi of y to the k be integral t to the k d theta of t. And then I can do this construction. I can form some new random variable, z equals x plus y and phi. And sort of the miracle that happens, and this is a theorem of Voigt-Kolescu, is that if you do this construction, then there exists some, I don't know, nu, which is a distribution, such that this nu phi nu of z to the k is integral t to the k d nu of t. So even though we were just really just sort of taking random variables, I mean, so if you remember the sum of squares things, like you might be afraid that you have sort of a pseudo distribution, right? Like the moments are defined, but like they didn't actually come from a real distribution. So it turns out in this case, you know, in this, if you do this free product, then what you get is actually corresponds to a valid distribution. And so you can actually try to figure out what this distribution is.
First of all, the sum of squares shouldn't worry you, because that, in that setting, you're not dealing with all the moments. I mean, that's the main.
That's correct. Yeah. That's,
so it's not relevant here. I mean, so why?
But the idea, but just given that, you know, just because I defined these moments.
But moments define a distribution.
Assuming that the distribution exists. Right, it could be, so this could be, like, for instance, it could be a...
No, you mean for the consequence.
The consequence is that this thing exists.
But at least the top part, mu and theta, it's equivalent, having a distribution.
Oh, of course, yeah. Yeah, so having this distribution is equivalent to having these guys. But then the question is, when I do this bizarro combination thing, is what comes out actually a distribution? Because it could be, for instance, a signed measure that gives you this, right? Which you don't want. Like, you want a strictly positive measure. Yeah?
So part of the point of what you're saying is that had you not used the free convolution definition of combining mu and theta to produce another distribution, you wouldn't be guaranteed that if you use the tensor.
So you are, it turns out you are guaranteed with the tensor, but
you might worry about it.
But you would worry about it, yeah. So this was something that was probably proved in, you know, your probability 101 class, that, you know, when you form this tensor product of probability spaces, that itself is a probability space. And it doesn't sort of, I don't know. I used to think, I was like, well, of course it is. But, like, you know, it's sort of.
Well, there's no intuition. You're just doing that. There must be an intuition why you get that.
I actually have no idea why you, I have no intuition as to why you get it. I mean, so I should mention that this entire sort of area is kind of amazing in some way, and that, like, Voiculescu just sort of invented the entire thing, like, over a span of like 5 or 6 years, and didn't really publish all that much until he was done, because he didn't really have, you know, he sort of had all of the building blocks but hadn't put them together. So, you know, he sort of single-handedly, you know, proved a lot of these things. But, you know, a lot of this, you know, his intention was to use this thing for, to understand operator algebras. So in particular, these spaces that you would get come from, like, the group algebra over some group, and then you would be able to do some calculations with these random variables, and that would tell you whether or not the initial groups were isomorphic. And so as far as applications to, like, random matrices and things, I think that was probably an afterthought at the time, but since then it's actually become a very useful thing. Yeah.
So I might be an idiot, but this is different from what you would have gotten had you done the usual.
The new would be different.
Yeah, I mean,
the new will be different. Absolutely.
New and
what you would get if you had done the tensor product. Yes.
Data would be different. Is it spectacularly different?
It is spectacularly different. So in particular.
I want to push you in the intuition direction, but it must be the case that this proof, it's not that it's for free convolution. It would work. There happen to be just two solutions, but it would work just axiomatically from the demands of consistency.
Yeah, there's some characterization of when this thing is comes from a positive measure or something like that. Yeah, yeah, like from
Also, I mean, Pasteur knew about all this stuff when he was doing random matrices. So he computed these distributions of density of states when you add to random matrices.
But he was sort of doing it brute force, probably. I mean,
well,
like, he didn't have.
But he got the same answer.
But yeah, exactly.
He got exactly the same answer.
Okay. Yeah. Exactly.
I wouldn't say it was completely out of the blue. People knew how to do this quite a while ago.
Yes, that's true.
I guess the point is that it's axiomatic. Whenever you glue things together this way, you get, if you start with distributions, you get distributions.
Yeah, you get distributions.
Yeah. I think what's more mysterious to me is why are there only two possible.
So that's where associativity comes in. Oh, so first of all, that's kind of a lie. So there's actually three possible ones if you don't force the identity to be in there. So if you allow yourself to have spaces that don't have the identity, then you can have a product called the Boolean product, which acts like phi of x1, y1, x2, y2. Is phi of x1, phi of y1, phi of x2, phi of y2. So you just essentially split everywhere a change in group begins, and you just put phi on all those guys. But if the identity is part of your group, then this doesn't work. It just doesn't fit it doesn't satisfy the commands that you need. I have absolutely no intuitive understanding of what this means.
It will also lead to a distribution if you start with
this will lead to a distribution, but it doesn't make sense to me what it would mean to have a distribution that doesn't have the identity in it. So I don't think that there are I don't think that there are very many interesting realizations of this that are known. Other questions before I move on?
By the way, where is non-negativity even mentioned in this whole story?
Okay, so I did skip over non-negativity because somehow you need phi to be a non-negative. So the problem is that if you really want to define these things, you need to define them on a star algebra. And then what you need is to show, you need to enforce the fact that phi of z star z is always greater than zero. So this is a property that you demand of z. It is whatever conjugate of z is.
What does it mean? We have formal variables.
So these are formal variables. So star is just some, is some inversion defined on, so it's such that it's just some map such that x plus y star is x star plus y star, and xy star is y star, and x star is x. So just you can pick whatever star is that satisfies these. Underneath the covers, in order to actually have this be a positive thing, there were some rules. But to be honest, everything that we'll ever use it for, at least I've ever seen it used for, follows these rules. So like the, I think it's not so
no,
big
to. Just when you say there exists a distribution, that's what you mean. Otherwise, there's no negativity.
Correct. Yeah. Okay. So any questions here? Okay. Good. So, as I've stated it so far, this is really not all that interesting or easy to deal with. Like you said, you know, you could actually sort of grind out all of these things by, you know, computing the moments or whatever. But one of the nice things that happens is that, you know, these phi of z's, when you combine these things, they should depend only on the phi of x's and the phi of y's, right? So that means if I had a moment generating function for x and a moment generating function for y, you might think maybe I can combine those in some way and get a moment generating function for z, because all the information is there, right? And the idea behind this is what's called linearization. So the goal is to, so let's say I have mx, which has the moments of x, my and mx plus y. These are, let's say, polynomials in T. What I want to do is I want to look for some function f such that f of mx of t plus f of my of t is f of mx plus y of t, where plus is either the tensor or the free product. Because then that would make things.
So in the case of the commutative, the tensor part, it is a convolution.
In the tensor part,
the product of this it will be the product.
Correct. So in that, so let me actually mention that. So let's do this for tensor product and addition. My claim is that if mv of t is sum over I phi of v to the I t to the I over I factorial. So you should be thinking expected value of e to the x t. Then log of mv of t plus log of mu of t is log of mu plus v of t under tensor product, tensor addition. And this is easy to check, right? I mean, so essentially this is, you can just plug these things in, right? So this will give you log of expected value of e to the xt times the expected value of e to the yt. And because of the rules of the tensor independence, this is expected value of e to the x plus y t, which is exactly what you want, log of this. OK, so this is what I meant by, you know, we can sort of turn this into power series computations. Essentially, if you knew nothing about any of the stuff that I previously told you, like you were just some computer who didn't understand what probability was whatsoever, you could still compute convolutions simply by doing this power series sort of thing, at least in the tensor case. In the free product case, it gets a little bit more complicated. In this case, we use historically what is called the Cauchy transform. So given mu, you get the Cauchy transform is g mu of t, which is integral d mu of s over t minus s, which you can sort of think of as the expected value of 1 over t minus x. Stiltjes transform, yeah. This is also called the Stiltjes transform. I've actually seen it called the Hilbert transform as well, but I don't think that that's actually standard. So things to notice about this. So first of all, this is not really a moment generating function, but it's close to a moment generating function in that if I define m mu of t to be 1 over t g mu of 1 over t, when I do 1 over t, this becomes 1 over t expected value of 1 over 1 minus x over t. Sorry, I don't know what I'm doing. 1 over t minus x, which becomes expected value of 1 over 1 minus tx, which, when you do the power series expansion of this, becomes sum over I expected value of x to the I, t to the I. So this is not really a moment generating function, but it's kind of close. You can get the moment generating function very easily from it. So a couple of things I want to mention about this. So first of all, this is only really defined. So it's only really defined on t, which is outside the support of mu. So in particular, you run into issues if, you know, mu was, for instance, the Gaussian, because then this thing is hard to define, and you have to start doing complex numbers and all these things, which becomes a pain. So For the most part, we really only are talking about distributions that have bounded support. And then you can pick some large enough S such that, you know, when you get big enough, you can evaluate this thing. The other thing I wanted to mention, especially since Tom is in the room.
So you would tell us the formula, what F is in the case of
Twitter. So I should mention when mu is discrete, then M mu of T becomes sum over I, probability of I, 1 over x minus I, where I is all of your different possible discrete points, which is the derivative of the sum over I log of x minus I to the p of I, which is the derivative of the log of pi over I x minus I to the p of I, which is a polynomial, assuming that you find the greatest common divisor, greatest common denominator of p, and factor it out and everything. So this will actually be important, and we'll use this. But now let me tell you what f is. So f in this case is what is known as the R transform. So the R transform, R mu of t, is defined as g mu of t inverse minus 1 over t. And this is what the linearization is. So R mu of t plus R theta of t is R mu plus theta t, where this is a free convolution. So the reason I wanted to mention this is because here you have a derivative, and then you're taking the inverse of it, which tells you that this is sort of related to the Legendre transform, which appears in numerous places. But essentially what this tells you is that that you can essentially compute these things by sort of, doing this. So I should mention why the minus 1 over t. So really all of the action is happening in the inverse. The reason that the minus 1 over t is here is because if you had mu equal to the 0 measure, so it was 0 with probability 1, then the Cauchy transform would be 1 over t. And if you invert 1 over t, that's 1 over t. And so when you add the zero thing, r mu of t plus r 0 of t, that should still be r mu of t, right? If you add 0 to something, like, it shouldn't change. So this is sort of the normalization that causes this to become a 0. So that's where this 1 over t comes from. But all of the action really is in this inverse. Questions? Now might be a good time to take a break. Five minutes, sounds good. Oh, this is how, using this? Oh, I didn't realize that. So I was under the impression that this really was what...
I started to use it all the time, so...
That why Voiculescu, why it took him so long, like...
I
You know, it's sort of the last piece of the puzzle was he couldn't figure out what this linearization was, and then. No, I don't think so.
That's why it took him time to.
Yeah. Well. That's, yeah.
You didn't think.
No, I mean, you know, Pasteur is a mathematician, by the way. I should say he's a mathematical physicist, so he proved things, but he didn't. He didn't abstract it in this way.
So the one thing that Voiculescu did seem to draw some stuff from was random walks on groups. So like random walks on Cayley graphs of groups and things like that. So I want to sort of go out of order because I haven't sort of mentioned, and I think it's probably time to mention at least what this thing is actually worth doing before I mention more properties of it. And this is a theorem of Voiculescu also. Let's let mu be a measure. Mu and theta. And let A be a matrix. Distribution. An be a sequence of n by n matrices such that the spectral measure of An approaches mu, and Bn a sequence of n by n matrices such that the spectral measure of Bn approaches theta.
So the spectral measure, you mean just the limit vector of
eigenvalues? Limit vector of eigenvalues. But really, I think the easiest way to think about it is that here there's an obvious linear function, right? Just 1 over n times the trace. So if I did 1 over n times the trace of a n to the k, this should converge to integral t to the k d mu of t for all k. So all of the moments are going to converge. And as a byproduct, like you'll get some vector of eigenvalues. And the claim is that if you look at the spectral measure of An plus QB Q transpose, where Q is a random unitary matrix, hard distributed. Unitary matrix, then as n goes to infinity, the spectral measure of this, Q is a hard distributed unitary matrix. Maybe there's a star here.
It's the same as if you put a random
computation. In some cases. That'll be next week. So the fact that that's true, yeah, is very special. But here you can think of, you know what the eigenvectors are. You know what the eigenvalues are, but you have no idea what the eigenvectors are. So you just sort of take them uniformly over all possible.
B is Bn.
B is Bn, yes, thank you. Then the spectral measure of An plus QBn Q star converges to, what did I call these things? Mu plus theta, where this is the free convolution.
Is the same thing true with permutations as Avi suggested?
Only in certain cases. So,
I don't know about permutations. It's much smaller.
So I think if AN and BN are diagonal, then it's probably true with permutations.
But you put something like this in your paper, no, it doesn't appear that.
Yeah, but we our AN and BN have to be very special. Yeah. I don't. This is certainly not true in general for permutation matrices. Okay, so essentially what this is saying is that if you are adding together two sort of random matrices, where by random I mean that you know sort of what the spectrum of the first one looks like and you know what the spectrum of the second one looks like, but you're sort of adding them together in some random way, sort of as independent as you possibly can, then in the limit, what you get is actually given by this free convolution.
So yes. Why did I just state it as limiting? Suppose I just gave you one matrix A and one matrix B and did this.
That distribution is hard to calculate.
But it's not going to be the free convolution.
No, no. It'll be off by something, yeah.
But what do you mean? I mean, a particular sequence I can take is the same matrix again and again.
Oh, no, but they have to get bigger as n goes to infinity.
Okay.
These are n by n matrices.
Oh, n by n, sorry. Right.
Yeah, so that's important.
So, no,
yeah.
Okay. So this is really the place of the so spectral measure, you mean just one over n
trace? Trace, yeah. So what he shows is that this converges in moments to the mu plus a. Yeah.
So you have a random distribution on the twisting.
Yeah.
So where is its randomness fitting into the convergence? I mean, over there, when you talk about spectral measures converging to mu and theta, there is no Q.
So this happens with probability one, essentially. So as n goes to infinity, Q will also get bigger and bigger and bigger.
Right, and your
the probability that this thing equals this thing happens with probability one as n goes to infinity. Yes. Yeah, it converges in distribution to this expected distribution, yeah. Good question. Other questions? Okay, so in the end, this is sort of why at least I find it interesting, is because when, for exactly things like Avi said, you know, if you have random permutation matrices, if this thing acts like these things act like, then you can sort of use this theory to sort of tell you what the right bounds are and what the, you know, and next week we'll see how to actually achieve bounds that beat these things. But for instance, let me do one calculation. Before I talk about something else. So let me do, so this gets back to when you were asking, are these fundamentally different? So let's take a mu to be Bernoulli 1 plus minus 1 with probability 1/2. And let's see, so mu plus mu in the tensor situation is going to look like it's going to be either minus 2, 0, or 2. This will be the probability 1/2. This will be probability 1/4. Let's see what happens when we do the free convolution. So in order to do the free convolution, we first need to do g mu of x, which is the Cauchy transform, which in this case is 1/2 1 over x minus 1 plus 1/2 x plus 1. Now we need to invert this. So let's see where this is. So it turns out the g mu inverse of x is 1 over 2x plus or minus square root of 4x squared plus 1 over 2x. And already this is now beginning to tell you why this is often much more complicated to do than the tensor product, because the only reason that we could really even invert this thing is because this became some quadratic equation. Right? As soon as you have more than two variables, you're going to have to be solving a cubic equation. That starts to get hard to do analytically. But fortunately, most of the interesting thing, a lot of the interesting things happen just in this quadratic case. Okay, so now I need to subtract off x. So r mu of x is g mu inverse of x minus 1 over x, which is just minus 1 over 2x plus or minus square root of 4x squared plus 1 over 2x. And now let me add, let's say, k of them together. Okay? So this will be r k mu is going to be minus k over 2x plus square root of k square root of 4x squared plus 1 over 2x, which means g k mu inverse of x. I need to add back a 1 over x. This is going to be 2 minus k over 2x plus or minus. Yeah, just the inverse. Plus k square root of 4x squared plus 1 over 2x. And then if I do this inversion again, which requires me to solve some quadratic equation, what I get is that g mu of x is k minus 2x.
GK
mu, thank you. Plus or minus the square root of x squared minus 4k plus 4. Over 2 times x squared minus k squared. And there's a way to invert this and get the actual distribution. And when you do it, the actual distribution is what's called the Keston-McKay. And you might have seen this because this is the distribution. This is the eigenvalue distribution of a D regular. It's the asymptotic eigenvalue distribution of a D regular graph. D is K, sorry. If k is 2, it looks something like that. So in particular, you add up two things that are plus or minus 1, and you get a continuous distribution. So this thing gets really, really different. It should be centered. Well, so now the question is, you know, let's say that you were wanting to be alone Bopana, and you were saying, you know, I want to know where the edge of this spectrum is. I don't even really need to invert this. Like, where I am right now, I can sort of look and see that.
By the way, what's the plus minus mean?
It ends up not mattering because when you, so what it means is that what actually is happening,
after you are inverting back, it doesn't matter.
You end up squaring, yeah. But it ends up being that, you know, here on this, in the complex plane, you have sort of like a branch cut or something where it's one of these things underneath and one of these things above, and then, so let's just look at when this thing is a real number versus an imaginary number. So if you look at when it is a real number, it is real when x squared minus 4k plus 4 is greater than or equal to 0, which is when x squared is greater than or equal to 4k minus 4, which is when absolute value of x is greater than or equal to 2 square roots of k minus 1. So this is telling you that the spectrum of, well, at least the free convolution of k Bernoulli random variables lives on minus 2 square roots of k minus 1, 2 square roots of k minus 1.
It looks like it's the opposite, something with the minuses. You want to say, I mean, you've got x greater than equal to.
Yeah, so this is where it's real, right? So remember, the Cauchy transform is only defined for t, which is outside the spectrum. So in order to get, so this is telling you where you're allowed to have t, which is outside the spectrum. Yeah. So this tells you that the actual spectrum is on here. So, right, and this is, if you don't already know, this is the alone Vopana bound for D regular graphs.
K
regular.
Maybe a dumb question. So how to prove that this free convolution is just the distribution of the K regular graph?
So that you actually need to actually show that this distribution is the same does not follow from any of this.
Oh.
I mean, like, so the real answer is that, let's say I was doing a heuristic and I wanted to know how deregular graphs behave. I would do exactly like what Avi said. I would say, like, look, how do I form a deregular graph? I would find a matching. I would pick a perfect matching, and then I would pick another perfect matching and union them, and pick another perfect matching and union them. And
something like the process over there
with permutation matrices.
Permutation.
Right, exactly. So now, what is that? That's doing M1 plus some Pn M1 Pn transpose plus doing this k times. So then the question is, what are the eigenvalues of the perfect matching? Well, the eigenvalues of the perfect matching are plus 1 with probability 1 half and minus 1 with probability 1 half. So heuristically, you can say to yourself, well, if this thing is acting in a free manner, then you should expect this thing to converge to whatever the thing is. But what I'll show next week is that you actually, there are things that you can derive from, you know, so acting in a free manner for finite graphs is actually much weaker. So you don't, you know, there are certain situations where you can derive bounds like this 2 square roots of k minus 2 square roots of k minus 1, 2 square roots of k minus 1, by knowing much less than this thing acts freely.
Although it's also the asymptotics is different here and here. I mean, here n grew and here n is fixed. This perfect matching is a perfect matching on n vertices, and you're permuting it around.
Correct, yeah. But then n is going to infinity.
N is uniformly going to infinity.
Yeah,
you're
n is
uniformly. You're doing this experiment in parallel for.
Yeah. Yeah, so essentially what it says is that, you know, if you have some situation where this thing acts randomly, if it happens to behave in a free manner, which it turns out lots of times it does, then not only can you calculate what you should expect this thing to act like, you can also sometimes turn that into existence proofs of things, which is what I'll talk about next week. And really, in the case where it doesn't act freely, like you're back in the same situation that you were before, where you essentially have to grind out all of the moments. So let me. Move on to what are called cumulants. So if you remember, we did this linearization in order to compute these convolutions. Right? In the free world, well, let me do in the tensor world, we found some f so that f of mu plus f of mv is f of mu plus v. And in the free world, we found some different g, so that g of, now we had g u plus g of g v equals g of g u plus v, where this happens when you have actual independence. This is when you have free independence. And so now let's look at something like the central limit theorem. So the central limit theorem says that if xi are mean 0, variance 1, independent, then the sum over the xi over square root of n goes converges in distribution to the normal n 0, 1. So because these guys are independent, I should be able to write this entire statement in terms of these guys. So these guys are called the cumulant generating functions. So right now I'm looking at the tensor product. Well, so both of them are cumulant generating functions. This is the tensor cumulant and these are the free cumulants. But whatever's happening here, I should be able to write using these guys up there. But then these guys are behaving exactly the same way that these guys are. I just don't know what distribution is causing me to have these free cumulants, right? So if I could figure out what distributions corresponded to the free cumulants in the same way that regular distributions correspond to tensor cumulants, then I would expect that exactly the same thing should happen, that I'd have these, the sequence of things that add up to you know, whatever corresponds to the Gaussian and in free probability. And that's exactly what you get. So somehow, cumulants are nice because it's sort of like the level playing field. Like once you get to cumulants, like, you know, all you're doing is adding power series together and you're forgetting the fact that it came from a free probability distribution or a tensor probability distribution either way. So, so in particular, you have so the normal free normal distribution is called the semicircle law. And it looks like this. Oh, more centered. And what the central limit theorem says is that if you know your AIs are mean, so phi of AI is 0 and phi of AI squared is 1, and you take the free sum of these guys, divide by square root of n, this converges to the semicircle law. Any questions there?
So what's the statement here?
So if the AI, so if the spectral measure of AI is such that phi of AI is 0 and phi of AI squared is 1 for all AI, and you take the free product of all these guys and divide by square root of n, then the spectral measure that comes out of this sum is the semicircle law.
So the case for matrices is a special case of this.
Case for matrices is a special case of this, yeah. You can also get things like the Poisson distribution. Or let me say the Poisson limit theorem. So normally the Poisson limit theorem says that if the xi go like Bernoulli P, and if NP goes to lambda as n goes to infinity, then the sum over the xi converges in distribution to Poisson on lambda. This is like the small law of small numbers or something like that. And you get almost exactly the same thing in free probability. So if you have, so essentially what it says is that if you have small rank one matrices and you AI and you add them up, this converges to what's called the Marchenko-Pashtur. So the Marchenko-Pashtur law is sort of the free probability version of the Poisson, and the semicircle law is the free probability version of the Gaussian. And then, well, so the point is that then you can sort of do, I mean, so statements like this are the reason, are, you know, the reason that, you know, what is that inequality that is escaping my mind at the moment? But even in just the tensor world.
No, but for matrices.
For matrices, this is,
general,
yeah.
Like
Chernoff bound, yeah. So Chernoff bound is essentially saying that, you know, the reason that you get this exponential decay is because if you sum up enough of these AIs, you're getting close to a Gaussian, right? So you can get similar sorts of statements that give you bounds on things and for random matrices using the fact that if you sum up enough of these things, you start getting close to a semicircle law. Yeah.
Is there, would you have guessed to begin with that the normalization, the 1 over root n, is going to be the same in the free case as the tensor case? I mean, is it obvious that it should be?
Yeah. So so if you just look at sort of how this thing filters through the cumulant generating function, it essentially just divides by this thing. Like it turns x into like x over square root of n or something like that. So whatever was happening, whatever normalization was causing this thing to work, the same normalization was going to cause this thing to work.
Well, in both cases, somehow the variance is additive. The dependence makes the variance is additive.
Exactly, yeah. And so essentially what ends up sticking around in both of these is just the variance term. So in the, so I should mention that the one problem with cumulants is that they have a horrible definition. So saying that cumulants are the things which, you know, add up when you're doing independent things is bad because if f of mu plus f of mv is f of mu plus v, the same thing is true about partial derivative of f. Same thing is true if you integrate f. Same thing is true if you multiply f by x plus 7. So it doesn't really narrow down, you know, what this actual thing is. And so there's this technicality that happens. So in the there's some renormalization, yeah. So in free probability, so the cumulant generating function in the tensor case looks like kappa 1 x plus kappa 2 x squared over 2 factorial plus kappa 3 factorial, so on. This is the tensor case. And in the free case, it looks like kappa 1 plus x kappa 2 plus x squared kappa 3, so on. But what's important is that in the top one, essentially what happens is this: when you do this a whole bunch of times, you converge to x squared over 2 factorial. That's the, and x squared over 2 factorial, if you reverse all of this, becomes the Gaussian. Here, this thing will converge to x because all that really is being added is the kappa 2s. But you can't do the, it becomes annoying in some situations. Because you would assume that, like, you know, that if this is the even playing field, that, like, you know, when you got to the cumulants here, that function would look exactly like the cumulants there.
But you've never said what the cumulant
is. This is the problem, is that cumulants are defined as the coefficients of the linearized power series. The problem is that linearizing the power series is not a unique operation. So in particular, so if this was a linearization of something, this would also be a linearization of the same thing, because all I'm doing is, you know, transforming the x's and things like that. So there's not like a, you know, you would sort of want to hope that, you know, you could prove this thing by saying, well, look, this thing converges to x squared over 2 factorial times kappa 2. The same thing has to happen to the free probability, and so then you're done. But it, there's some shift going on here that's that becomes annoying.
In fact, it seems from the bounded spectrum that the normalization should be maybe square root n minus one.
Right, yeah.
So this is the end of the spectrum that should be in the normalizing.
Yeah, I mean, essentially you want to do it in such a way that it, it maintain it contain it stays bounded and has a constant width or whatever.
Yeah, the factor of two seems to matter. I mean, it seems like it's more, the free probability is more concentrated.
Free probability
less concentrated. A little less concentrated.
Is less concentrated, yeah.